Hey everyone, this is Tammy Painter, and you're listening to the Book Owl Podcast, the podcast where I entertain your inner book nerd with tales of quirky books and literary lore. We have made it to episode 8, and if you turn the number 8 on its side, what does it look like? Okay, well, it kind of looks like a drunken snowman who's toppled over, but it also resembles something that makes reading possible for about 65% of the population, and that is the topic of this week's episode. Before we jump into the episode, I just want to remind you that if you have been enjoying the show, you can help keep the episodes coming in several inexpensive ways, whether it's buying the Book Owl a virtual cup of coffee or sending the owl a monthly snack. Your support is very much appreciated. So if you have an extra couple dollars or euros or pounds, please head over to thebookowlpodcast.com/support. And yes, that link will be in the show notes. All right, let's get a closer look at toppled over snowmen. No, wait, sorry. Take two. Let's take a look at eyeglasses. Okay, you're probably thinking, wow, how boring and off topic can you get? Isn't this show supposed to be about books? Well, okay, to look at them, glasses aren't the most exciting things on the planet. Although Elton John's collection might be the exception. But glasses happen to coincide with a couple of other inventions to truly boost literacy and people's love of the written word, and that's why I chose it for a topic for this podcast. But the first glasses, kind of like Elton John's, really had nothing to do with improving literacy. It was all about style. See, the Emperor Nero, he liked to wear emerald lenses. And when I say emerald, I mean the gem emerald, not just emerald tinted. Anyway, he wore these to gladiator fights because he believed they offered some sort of health benefit, and if the emperor did it, the masses soon followed. So Nero may have started the first optical wear fashion trend. The idea of using a curved lens to magnify things probably came about soon after glass was invented. I mean, it doesn't take a huge stretch of the imagination to picture a glassmaker setting a piece of work down and noticing whatever was underneath looked bigger, right? And back in the 2nd century, Ptolemy was already writing about this very phenomenon. But it wouldn't be put to much use until the Arab scholar Ibn al-Haytham, I hope I'm saying that right, who in the 10th century first suggested that glass could be used to aid with visual problems as people aged. Unfortunately, he didn't really push this idea, and it wasn't until his book of optics was translated into Latin in the 1200s that the idea really took hold. Now, this was back when monks would spend their entire days in scriptoriums copying books letter by letter, and it was often very tiny letter by letter if you've ever seen these manuscripts. So once a monk reached a certain age, his vision would be fried, and he could no longer do this work. When Al-Haytham's book of optics was translated, older monks quickly adopted the idea of using reading stones, and I'll get to what a reading stone is pretty soon, using the reading stones so they could continue to scribble away and feel useful. And when I say they quickly adopted this idea, I mean quickly, because within only a few years of Al-Haytham's book being translated, people were already writing of using lenses, and I quote, to read the smallest of letters. But as I said, starting out, these lenses weren't true lenses. They were just reading stones. And a reading stone was about maybe an inch thick and 4 inches in diameter, and was made of rock crystal and quartz that was curved on one side and flat on the other. You would then place the flat side on a page and move it along so it would enlarge the words underneath as you read. So we've got the monks improving their lives with the little reading stone, but meanwhile, right about this same time over on the islands that make up Venice, a renaissance of glassmaking was happening. And competition was fierce, like crazy fierce, between the glassmakers to come up with the best techniques to make the best glass possible. That competition was so strong that the guild masters kept their glassmakers, known as cristalleri, kept them basically as prisoners on the island they happened to work on. This kept the cristalleri from flouncing around on gondolas spilling trade secrets to the cristalleri on other islands, right? The rules were so strict that if a Cristallary left his island, he could face the death penalty. It was a bit over the top, but this forced isolation meant intense collaboration, and the Venetian glassmaking skills just skyrocketed. This boon in glassmaking not only meant clearer glass, but also thinner glass that could be shaped more precisely. No source I could find knew who first took this better quality glass, stuck it into a wooden holder, and used it to help people see better, or exactly when they did this. But most sources are certain it happened in Italy, so we at least know where. What we do know is that in 1306, Giordano of Pisa gave a sermon in which he's quoted as saying, "It is not 20 years since there was found the art of making eyeglasses." And we can probably narrow down not just these eyeglasses being made in Italy, but we can probably hone in on somewhere near Venice. Because by the time that sermon was given, there were already records on the books in which the Venice guilds regulated the sales of eyeglasses. These glasses that we're talking about right now, they weren't what we have today that fit neatly on your face with the arms and the nose bridge. Instead, what you had were two lenses set into two separate wooden frames, and the wooden frames kind of had a little handle sort of thing coming down, and at the base of that handle, they were attached with a pivot, and so you could open the pivot to, you know, to fit the width of your eyes. And so I'm going to guess, I'm not sure, I should have looked this up, I'm going to guess that because you had these two pieces that you were putting on your face, that that is why we say a pair of glasses. Anyway, enough of my guessing. The first painting to show someone wearing this type of glasses dates from 1352. This painting was done by Tommaso da Modena, and it shows Cardinal Hugh St. Clair with a pair of these glasses balanced on his nose as he's working away on some document or other. And it's kind of significant that in this first painting, the subject is a cardinal. See, glasses were not cheap. There was no $49 special being offered at the lens crafters or anything. Glasses were a luxury item that signified wealth and power and were owned by only a few of the elite. But remember Giordano of Pisa, who gave that sermon a while ago? Well, he had a colleague by the name of Friar Alessandro della Spina, who didn't think this was fair. I mean, literacy rates were pretty low, but those who did read really needed to read, even after they managed to live to the ripe old age of 40, when many people's eyes start getting wonky. Of course, my eyes have been wonky since I was 3, but that's a whole different issue. Anyway, Alessandro somehow, I don't know how or why, Alessandro somehow dipped his hands into the lens making business and made pairs of glasses for whoever needed them. And Giordano, while delivering a good bit of marketing for his friend, also proved he was a bit snarky because he said, quote, "Glasses were first made by someone who didn't want to share. Spina made them and shared them with everyone with a willing and cheerful heart." Good on you, Spina. This didn't mean glasses were owned by the masses yet, but they were being seen and used more frequently. So all this is happening in the second half of the 1300s, and that's also right about the time when Europeans were figuring out how to make paper cheaper and more efficiently. Since books had been made with parchment or vellum, which is expensive and laborious to make, this papermaking set things up perfectly for things to come, because when the 1400s roll around, our friend Johannes Gutenberg invents his printing press. Books and journals, which had all been hand-copied before and were insanely expensive, suddenly dropped in price and became more plentiful thanks to the papermaking and the printing press. And people wanted that printed material, but they also wanted to be able to read it, right? And thanks to the regulations around making and selling eyeglasses and lenses loosening up, glasses were also becoming more plentiful and soon became a household commodity. And I just love it when history things like this fall into place like that. I mean, think about how amazing this blend of events is. You've got an Arabic book on optics being translated, monks latching on to that idea of being able to keep working long into old age, the lockdown of glassmakers forcing them to improve their craft, the invention of glasses, a more efficient way to make paper, and the printing press all coming together. If any one of those things hadn't happened, maybe the printing press would have needed longer to take off, and maybe reading would have languished behind another couple hundred years, which might have delayed the Renaissance and other leaps in thinking. I mean, who knows, but I don't think it's a coincidence that only a couple decades after the printing press was first invented, that the first eyeglasses shop was opened in Strasbourg, which also happens to be the city where the printing press was born. So, just to wrap up a couple more moments in glasses history, up to this point, people knew lenses needed to be convex to do their trick, but no one really understood why. Then in 1604, Johannes Kepler, and he's the guy who figured out the planets travel in elliptical orbits instead of circular orbits. He also figured out the different properties and uses of convex versus concave lenses. And about 20 years later in Spain, someone figured out how to create different grades of lenses for different vision problems. Thank you, whoever that was. Of course, through all this, we're still stuck with that weird pivoting style of frame that you had to either balance on your nose or hold in front of your eyes. It wouldn't be until the 1700s before glasses got arms and were held together by a bridge across the nose. Yeah, they weren't exactly rushing into that invention. And now comes my favorite bit of glasses trivia that I found when I was researching this episode. In the 1800s, lenses were tinted green. And this was not in honor of the Emperor Nero's fashion sense. It was because they believed it cured syphilis. I don't know why. But who knows, maybe that's why Nero wore his emerald lenses. Okay, back to what this has to do with books. Some of you lucky listeners may not need glasses to read, but 75% of adults need some sort of vision correction, and 65% of those wear reading glasses. We know that kids with undiagnosed vision issues are resistant to reading, they lag behind in school, and may never learn to enjoy books. I personally wouldn't be able to read anything but the largest of large print books without my glasses, and sometimes I struggle with my glasses. So, in my opinion, glasses are a vital part of literacy and enjoying books and in being a lifelong reader. And I'm gonna wrap up this episode with a little public service announcement. If you have old eyeglasses sitting around in a drawer, you can clear out that drawer by donating your glasses to several charities, including United for Sight, Eyes of Hope, the Lions Club, and many others. And usually your optometrist will have a drop-off box, as will most eyeglasses shops. Okay, everyone, that is it for the show. If you want to stick around for my updates, that would be great. If not, thanks for listening, and I will hoot at you next time. Okay, as far as podcast news goes, along with episode 3, which I told you about last time, I have now updated episode 2 and tried to fix an issue I had with the volume level. The trouble is that some of these issues, like volume levels and sort of like a vibration you hear, don't come through when I'm listening to the playback on my audio software. It only comes through after I've uploaded it to the podcast sites, which is really frustrating and is a nightmare to hunt down the problems. Anyway, it's still not perfect, but until I get motivated to completely re-record these first episodes, it'll have to do. In my writing world, I have finished the edits on both my short story I wrote in June and on the first book of my Cassie Black Trilogy. Yay! I also have a bunch of specials going on this month, including some half-price deals on my box sets. So if you want to try out my work and save some money, I'll have a link in the show notes that'll direct you to a blog post where I've listed all my deals for the month. All right, this time, that really is it. Thanks so much for listening, and be sure to get your eyes checked. The Book Owl Podcast is a production of Daisy Dog Media, copyright 2020, all rights reserved. The theme music was composed by Kevin McLeod.